joining me this afternoon. I want to get started on time because we have 30 minutes. 30 minutes of entertainment, I promise you, it will be entertaining. And my goal of today is to allow you to walk away with sort of three key points that we're going to talk about around designing a self-service strategy. My name is Steve Proger. I head up global sales and business development for a company called Smart Action. I've actually been in the contact center space for about 10 years, and I primarily work on customer experience in the contact center space. So I've got a group of customer experience and innovation folks out there that are working in the customer experience side of it for contact centers. A little interesting thing about me is I have an interesting accent that you're going to pick up on. It's called a Canusa accent. Does anybody know what a Canusa accent is? No? Okay. Born and bred in Canada, but I've been living in the USA for the last 7 years, so it's a Canusa accent because I've picked up some regional diction from where I've been living. Thank you. Yeah, I know you'll pick up on it. That's good. But I'm excited to be here and talk to you folks about designing a self-service strategy. And it's interesting because when you think about your world and you think about the contact center space, first of all, how many people are in the contact center space? Excellent. How many people have called a contact center over their lifetime? All right. So if you are in the contact center space, how many people would love to have this customer every single day? Very nice, right? Would love to talk to you. Brilliant. How many people get this customer every single day? Yeah. So the interesting thing is the relationship has changed between the consumer and the agent, okay, the CSR. Right? The relationship has changed because of a number of reasons that is going on in our world, and a lot of it are expectations due to technology. And that's what we're living with today. So what I want to walk you through a little bit is sort of what does that mean in the world of contact centers? What kinds of technologies and that you should be thinking about from a self-service strategy? And then more importantly is how would you approach it? Because if it was me, I've been in the contact center space for 10 years, every time I walk into a contact center and begin working with them, I put a hat on as if I'm an owner. And I want to think about how would I approach the project to begin with self-service. And in our world in particular, we're starting to get some challenges out there. And so what I want to talk you through real quickly is, you know, the changing customer expectations I talked about. I do want to talk to you about conversational AI. AI is a big buzzword. Everybody's heard about it. Okay? But then more importantly, walk you through some use cases around it and where to start. Okay? So when I think about what's been changing out there, We're a partner of Gartner, so our company is a client of Gartner. They're a big analyst and all that, if you guys have heard of them before. And so in working with Gartner, they're telling us a few things. First of all, two-thirds of the consumers out there want to be able to self-serve. So it's a priority. Right? I mean, I just want to be able to figure it out myself. I want to be able to either go online, I want to use my mobile, I want to be able to make a phone call, and try to get it done without maybe even having to talk to somebody. Okay, so that's the first thing that's going through most consumers' heads. Again, two-thirds of them. Now, the interesting thing that's changed in the last 3 years in particularly is that 72% of the consumer is their level of expectation is much higher now. When they actually contact you, they expect you to know them. They're saying, well, you've got all this data on me, you've got an account on me, you should know what my expectations are, you should know what my preferences are. So why am I starting everything from scratch again when you have all this information? And then the last thing is where Gartner is predicting. And what Gartner is predicting is by the year 2020, which is really just, you know, we're on the heels of it right now. By the year 2020, 85% of the relationship that you have with a brand is going to be without the use of the human touch. So your relationships are going to come from where? Your relationships are going to come from marketing programs. They're going to come from video, from audio, vlogs, blogs, anything that you can think of going online without connecting with a human. So that's interesting, right? I mean, that means that I'm going to be able to connect with brands without really talking to anybody and not relying on that human connection. Now, that does change a lot in the contact center space, and we do know that there is definitely a need for that human interface and that human connection. So how do you take a strategy to figure out self-service and intersect that with the live agent, right? That's the, that's oftentimes what we look at. Now, the interesting thing is, and I'll tell a story real quickly. So how many here have an Amazon Alexa at home? Excellent. Besides music, how many use it beyond music? Okay, so numbers came down a little bit. I have four in my house. Okay, I have one in each of my kids' rooms, and I have one in the kitchen, and I got one in my office. Right? So what do? Alexa, please tell Mia it's time to wake up. All of a sudden, in my daughter's room, Mia, Dad says it's time to wake up. Okay? And then Mia gets up, she wanders around, she says, Alexa, play my wake-up music. Music comes on, she starts going around, she gets ready, she's a 12-year-old, so she listens to all the popular stuff. And so I've got four of those in my house right now. I never planned on having four of them in my house, but my kids kept walking into the kitchen all the time wanting to put on their music, so that was the first thing. And then the second thing is, I started seeing more of the ads and reading the articles around how could I use Alexa, right? I get an email at least twice a week on new things that I can ask Alexa, and so I'm always trying to figure out, you know, what's the latest thing that I can do. And then I kind of got a little creeped out when they said that Alexa is going to giggle and laugh without you even asking it to. And I'm like, okay, how do I fix that one? That's on Amazon to fix. So anyways, the customer expectations are changing a lot. You're being influenced by the technologies that are out there today. Okay, so the use of Google Home, the use of Amazon Alexa is really going to influence that relationship that I talked about. Okay, the relationship between the human, consumer, member, guest, whatever you want to call them, and your live agent, your CSR, is being influenced from all this technology. Okay, so that's kind of crazy on what's happening out there. And so what that means to us in the contact center space is the impact of this means that when we look at all of the conversations that happen in your world, and I say conversations, could be calls, could be texts, could be chats, could be whatever you want to call them. These are conversations that are happening. You've got a series that are simple, that are probably being handled already, you know, DTMF, press one, press two, press three, help me to get where I need to get to. You've got a chunk that are really complex, and then you've got the ones that can only ever be handled by the human, okay? So when you look at your world and you say, well, yeah, this is kind of where I am, right? This is sort of what we thought this was going to look like, but what everyone wants, what the consumer wants, and what you guys want is this, right? You want to be able to say, again, two-thirds of the consumer want to automate. So I want to be able to figure out what can I do to be able to automate more within my world because the consumer wants to do that. And what we get challenged with, this is really funny, because I'm an Amazon Alexa user, and it's funny, you're either in one of two camps, you're either an Alexa user or you're a Google Home user. Right? I use both whenever I'm out talking, but what I find is our clients come to us and say, you know what, when we do surveys, we do voice of the customer, they say, why can't you just sound like Alexa? I mean, I can talk to Alexa, and Alexa gives me my answers. I've got clients that I'm working with in the U.S. right now that are building applications through Alexa to allow them to check on things. So it's building the skills out to be able to check on things within their world. So what happens is when they call another brand, they're like, you know, why can't you just sound like Alexa? And that's where we start to look at this whole AI world. Now, Amazon Alexa is interesting and all, but what I really want to bridge into a little bit more is a platform that's called Conversational AI. So conversational AI is a blending of many, many different kinds of technologies out there, but the way you think about it is the communicator. It is a virtual agent, right? A lot of people have heard of virtual agents, right? You've heard of bots, okay? So chatbots, as an example, are one form of a conversational AI tool, right? But it incorporates a lot of different things that are in here. So advanced speech recognition, it's got artificial intelligence, it's got natural language understanding and processing, machine learning, so it's constantly learning, okay? But this is the communicator, and it's different than other forms of AI. You know, like IBM Watson, as an example, is an analytics company, right? They take a lot of data, and they run analytics, and then they figure out what answers need to be popped up, and they go there, but this conversational AI platform has got the ability to communicate. And what it does is it mimics what the live agent does. Okay, and I'm going to go through some use cases so you understand what that means and what that looks like. So these kinds of technologies are starting to influence the way consumers think and the way they intersect with brands. And the tricky part is, and this is what you guys will start to face over the next 5 years, is that the demand on what you're doing in your business from a self-service strategy is going to start to rise, and you're going to be pressured to sort of follow. You got to know where you're going to go and what you're going to do. Okay? So when I look at it, and this is the biggest thing that we see, is conversational AI in the contact center needs to be personalized and it needs to be effortless. Because the reality is, when people contact you, they're going to want to know, do you know me? Right? Do you know who I am? You should. I got a phone number, right? When I call in, you should know who I am based on that. Do you know what I did before? So can I go back into the system and see what happened? Right? So if you've got a predictive system that can say, hey, I saw you called 3 days ago, or you put a claim in 3 days ago, then, you know, are you calling about that claim? Yes, that's what I'm calling for. And then the last thing is, can you anticipate my needs? Okay, so this is what happens from the consumer. They're trying to say, look, I need you to anticipate what I want. So when we're thinking about conversational AI, it needs to be personalized and effortless. So gone are the days of the old clunky IVRs or the original speech IVRs that came out about 15, 20 years ago, right? Because that stuff just frustrates people. Guy that I showed at the beginning, that's what happens, right? People get really frustrated with that stuff. So moving into a conversational AI platform helps you sort of to achieve this. So let me go through some case studies, because I think you guys will get a kick out of this. So we started working in the healthcare space about 4 years ago. And one of the healthcare companies that we took on a pretty long customer journey with is a medical device firm. And they are the largest U.S. shipper of durable medical equipment, DME, okay, durable medical equipment. And so in their world, they had a few challenges. The first thing is, where they were located in the U.S., they could not get anywhere near enough talent to be able to work for them. They couldn't get enough people in the call center to be able to help them. Now, instead of outsourcing and everything, they were trying to figure out how could they grow their business, and they're growing pretty rapidly. So they decided to start automating and providing self-service. So we implemented a number of different things, but one of the things that you can see here in the healthcare side of it is we have initially just a simple account authentication. So think about it, I'm calling in, I need to reorder my incontinence supplies, right? I'm 60 to 70 years old, somewhere in there, it's an older demographic, and so they're calling in. First thing that happens is they find out, okay, I see you're calling from this phone number. Is this Mr. Jones? Yeah, this is Mr. Jones calling. Perfect, great, Mr. Jones. Do you have your account number with you? Oh, no, I don't have it. Okay, can you tell me what your birthday is? All right, my birthday is March 21st, 1950. Great, okay. So that's your birthday. Let me do one more piece of account authentication so I know that it's you. And then I'm going to move on to the next thing. Now, once they authenticate, and what we're finding is 96% of those patients are engaging with the system. The reason why they're engaging is because the system knows who they are, right? So figure out, first of all, what you can do that helps you to know who they are. That's the first thing. And then what we also found is, based on the data integration, that 75% are authenticated. So by the time it gets to an agent, by the time it gets to a CSR, the CSR doesn't have to re-authenticate anymore, right? The CSR is like, oh, hey, Mr. Jones. Yeah, sure, no problem. I made that order for you right away. And what we do is we serve up to the CSR, hey, red light or green light. And if it's a red light, meaning we couldn't authenticate them, we tell them where we couldn't authenticate them. Because what happens in this world is it's not always the end user that gets the product, it's a caregiver that's calling to reorder the product. So what we'll say is, are you a caregiver? Yeah, we're a caregiver, okay, great. And then we authenticate off the caregiver. And then we get to the reorder side of it. So you think about the customer experience on it, and you think about what the agent is going through. If I can serve up to an agent a real easy, hey, yeah, let me put that order for you, not a problem, but not have them go through the mundane, okay, account authentication, what's your birthday, right, what's the last 4 years social, whatever it is that you're using to authenticate on, then it makes it easier for them. And so for this, initially, just off this one application, we're taking 40,000 to 50,000 minutes per month out of the contact center. So thinking about conversational AI, you're able to take shave minutes. That's what you're thinking about, shaving minutes out of the contact center. But then it's expanded. So we do things like order status, supply reorders, and account updates. And it's a combination of both inbound and outbound. 35% of our business is outbound. So what we do is we call out to Mr. Jones and say, hey, Mr. Jones, I see you're due for a subscription refill. Do you want us to refill that for you? Oh, yeah, that would be great. What you hear in the calls, what's really funny is you hear in the calls, he turns around and says, hey, Margaret, they're calling me to reorder this stuff. This is great. I'm glad they called me. So this is a customer experience where we're not only taking inbound, but we're doing outbound. And for the patient, because these are patients, this is very confirming for them, and it's security, right? And they feel like they're taking care of me. And that's important, right? So when we look at all the different applications, we're doing a number of things. Now, interesting thing about JMB Medical, which is the name of this company, we are, just for them alone, within the conversational AI world, we're 14 applications through a 22 application roadmap. So they're automating more and more as much as they can, because what happens is there's two paths, right? There's two adoption paths that always happen. There's the patient adoption path, or the consumer, or the member, or the guest, whatever you want to call them. It's their adoption path. And then the second thing is the internal adoption path. So the company had to adopt it. The agents had to adopt it. So that they knew that the customer experience now has changed. That by the time the patient actually reaches the agent, the level of service is not the same, hey, let me authenticate you. It's, they're already authenticated, great, now I can help you. And what's funny is they've actually got better employee engagement now. So this company has seen an uptick on their employee engagement scores by about 0.5. So instead of it being a 4 out of 5, it's a 4.5 out of 5 now. Because their agents are doing what they always wanted to do. They want to help their patients, they want to help their customers. And they don't want to have to do all the mundane stuff. So that's a byproduct of conversational AI. So this is one use case. Let me get you guys to another use case really quickly. So in the subscriber services space, there's a company out there called Textile. You guys may or may not have heard. Any of the ladies heard of JustFab? JustFab? Okay, JustFab. They got Fabletics, JustFab, Shoe Dazzle, and they got Fab Kids. So it's an ongoing subscription base. So you pay $39.95 a month, and you get a pair of shoes that shows up at your door every single month. Right? Kind of cool, right? So what happens in their world is they get a ton of conversations. I don't want to say just phone calls, because it's conversations that are happening. And in their world, you can either cancel your subscription, right? You can cancel it. Yeah, don't need it anymore. You can suspend it for a month. Hey, I just want to stop. I don't want anything this month. I'm good. Or I actually want to sign up, because I haven't signed up before. So that's just one of the functions that we're doing for them under a subscriber services base. And what happens is we also program into it some incentives. So in the conversational AI world, as long as we have the data connections, we'll look back into the data system, we'll say, they haven't called to cancel before, they haven't called to suspend before. So I'm gonna offer them a $10 credit. So when they call in and say, oh, I just wanna cancel my membership. Okay, well, I see you haven't canceled it before. I can offer you a $10 credit for this month if you want to keep it and you get your new pair of shoes. And then if you want to cancel next month, no worries. Right? We're getting a better conversion rate in the system than their human agents are on retaining attention from that type of program. Because what happens is that oftentimes the human that's speaking to the conversational AI platform is like, okay, now I'll hang on to it. Right? And then it goes on and it moves. So, in the world of conversational AI, it's not a directed dialogue conversation. It is dynamic, right? And you're able to anticipate and understand what's going on. You see the data. You can see that they haven't done anything before, or they have done something before. So if that same person called back again next month and said, I want to cancel, the system doesn't offer them another $10 credit. The system says, okay, sorry to see you go. And they cancel the membership. But then that goes into their marketing campaign to remarket to them over and over and over again to get them to sign up again. Okay, so you think about that in a business world sense. So subscriber services as an industry, we take a look at all the different things that we can potentially automate. And in a self-service strategy, we've identified across 10 different industries. So if we're thinking about retail, if we're thinking about healthcare, if we're thinking about utilities, anything like that, what we do is we identify the core. So order management, appointment management, subscriber status, pause and restart services, loyalty programs. We've thought about the core things. And then all of these things, for the most part, are across every industry. So I can do authentication intelligent front door across every industry. I can do scheduling across every industry. And that's because of the way the conversational AI platform did. Okay, so when we think about an industry, the key point I want to make to you guys is there are core services in your world, I guarantee, that you can look at and say, so for self-service, I need to start somewhere. Let's start with one of the core functions, okay, and start to automate. Now, the last thing that I'll leave with you guys, making sure that I'm on time, I got about another 9 minutes here, is roadside assistance. We built our business on roadside assistance, so SmartAction is the world leading provider of automated roadside assistance. Okay, we are the self-service gurus when it comes to roadside service. And you're thinking, well, that roadside service, that sounds pretty easy, right? I mean, the reality is I call up and I need to get my car towed. So how hard is that? It's seamless to the member, and it needs to be seamless to the member. So the member calls up and says, all right, I need to get my car towed. Okay, great. Do you know where you are? No, I'm stuck on the side of the road somewhere. Okay, great. I'm going to send you a text. I need you to click on it, and like an Uber map, you tell me where you are. And when they click on it, that data comes back into our system. And then what happens is we say, okay, we're triaging what the problem is. We're trying to find out, do I need to send out a tow truck, or do I need to send out a light duty truck? That's what I'm trying to figure out, right? So I'm triaging. So tell me what's wrong. My battery won't start, or I got a flat tire, okay? Or I hit a tree, something like that. So we're triaging the issue. And then we figure out what truck actually needs to get sent out. And then we tell them, we say, okay, great. I'm going to now go and find a provider for you. And then I will call you back, or I will text you back on what the ETA of that provider is, when that truck is going to show up. Is that okay? Yes, that's fine. So what happens from there is we then hang up, and then we will go back, and we will start dialing out, or we will text out, to all the third-party providers that are out there that are closest to them, based on GPS, that has the truck that we need within the time frame that we need in order to complete it, in order to assign it to them. As soon as the person says, yes, I can do that, I can meet the time frame and I have the tow truck, then they get the details from the GPS that we pulled from their phone. It gets sent to them, they get the work order, and then we then loop them in, so we loop the truck in with the customer. If it's via text, awesome. And we send out a text and it says, here is the truck driver, here's who's coming to pick you up, it's Joe's Trucking, here's a picture of Joe, so they know who's going to show up. And then the member at that point in time says, oh great, okay, that's who's coming. That's all done without the use of a live agent. That is done through conversational AI technologies. Now, the interesting thing is, when we began this, our first fear was, these are people that are stuck on the side of the road. Do you really want to automate this? The interesting part is most of them want the automated system. And we did a sample of 33,000 surveys across all of the AAA clubs that we work with, and they rated us higher than the live agent on this particular functionality. So they rated the automation higher from a happiness and intent to recommend and reuse than they did on the live agent. Because it's fast, it's seamless, right? They don't have to worry about it, and we communicate it back. Okay, so that's the way you look at it. Now, couple things, where to start, some ideas for you. When we begin taking a look at this and we start talking about, we're trying to find some commonalities. So sometimes companies that we work with have peak demand. They're trying to do security, secure self-service. We're trying to figure out, do you have long wait times, high attrition? You know, if you have a tough time keeping your agents, sometimes there's some things that you're just going to have to automate in order to be able to figure out that I can take my agent now, and instead of, you know, hiring potential, you know, low-end agents, I'm going to actually pay a little bit more and hire specialists. Because that's what conversational AI does. It creates specialists in the contact center space. Cost reduction, limited hours of operation. So oftentimes we're doing after-hours work. So because the service is available 24 hours a day, you don't need an agent there 24 hours a day. We can do that. So we're trying to figure out where's the best way to start. And what you really want to do from those core services that I showed you, you want to figure out what's going to get you the best ROI. The reality is you guys have to make a business case. to be able to say within your own company, what am I going to automate? If I have to provide self-service, what am I going to automate? And so we look for the best way to start, pinpoint the best conversation to start with. We're not going to boil the ocean, just one thing, and then we build off of it. Okay, and that's one of the key things I'm going to let you guys know. Start small. You don't need to start big. You don't need to invest $1 million in building a self-service strategy and then get going on it. Just start with one small thing and then roll it out and then expand it. The other thing that we think about is leveraging data. So, you know, what's driving the customer inquiries? What are the top 10 call drivers in your business? What are the current business challenges you face? So one of our trucking companies was facing a safety issue. And so instead of having their drivers touch tone, pressing buttons when they first, you know, when they're trying to dial the company, we did a natural language front door. So when they called in, it was all natural language. All they had to do was speak. That's all it was. And then they got to where they needed to get to. So that solved the safety issue for them, right? Okay, and then we look at, you know, which process offers ROI with automation. So again, back to that point. The one thing that I do want to touch on, and make sure I'm still on time, I got a few more minutes, is think about the agent as a specialist and how that's going to evolve. Okay? So give the agents access, involve them in the process, you know, figure out that when the call has to get to an agent, it's going through a conversational AI platform, there is data that needs to go with it. So that you're teaching and training the agent to say, hey, when this call comes to you and there's a screen pop and it tells you what the conversation was before it got to you, take 5 seconds, look at it, and say, okay, this is where we are. Hey, Mr. Jones, I can help you out. I can finish this off for you. Right? So involve the agent in helping them to know what that new customer experience is going to feel like. Seamless conversations. Don't just, you know, we all know this, and I'm probably preaching to the choir. Don't get them to repeat everything that they did. You know, when we began a process with one of our companies, we found out that the agent was actually re-authenticating again. So we had them authenticate in our system, gave it to the agent. The agent said, let me just check, is your address this and your phone number is this and this and this? I'm like, oh, guys, we just did all that. Like, why are you having them repeat information that causes frustration? And the last thing is, I know you're all thinking about omni-channel. It's gotta be unicorns, interesting concept. But think about the multi-channel world offering multiple channels. The idea is, in your conversational AI platform, you should be able to build it once and then deploy it multiple times. Okay, and that's it. Look for those types of solutions. And that talks to my point about avoiding silos. But the last thing is, and I talked about this a little bit before, so set expectations. There's two adoption paths here. There's a consumer, member, guest, customer, whatever you want to call them. It's their adoption path. And that's why we talk about starting small, because they have to get used to that. They have to get used to talking to a conversational AI platform. How many people that have the Amazon Alexa today knew everything that Amazon Alexa could do when you got it? I certainly didn't. All right? And so I had to start to get used to how I'm going to use it on a day-over-day basis, and I had to think about it. So there's a consumer adoption path, and the second thing is there's the internal adoption path that you need to think about when you're in your self-service strategy. Okay, so those are the two things. And then, so here's the three key takeaways that I want to leave with you guys. In fact, if you're so inclined, you can always pop onto smartaction.ai/5best, and you'll get the 5 best practices for a successful self-service strategy. It's a white paper that was written by a number of our customer experience innovation folks. And so the first thing is conversation AI is going to be the key to self-service strategy. We're exposed to it. Your consumers are exposed to it. They're going to expect it. So it's going to be this dynamic push-pull. The second thing is start with the best ROI and expand. So it's funny, I was at a conference a couple months ago, and one of the speakers got up there and said, if there's one thing I can tell you, it's going to be two words. Just start. Don't try to build the monolithic rip and replace. Just start. Start with one thing, something simple. I don't know, order status calls. Where's my order? Sounds simple, right? There's so many derivatives of where's my order and what that customer experience needs to look like, but start somewhere first. Second, and the third and last is, artificial intelligence is meant to enhance the human interface. It's not meant to replace them, at least not for a long time. So think about it that way, and involve the people that are in your organization, because they're going to need to adopt it. So thank you very much for the time. I appreciate it. If anybody has any questions, I'm here. Richard's here. Happy to help you guys out.